This is Smart Money with Joe Smith and Julia Anderson.
Joe and I are so excited at Smart Money to have a guest expert with us today, Andy Hunt, who is the president of the Oregon Computer Consultants Association. Is that right?
That's right, indeed.
And he's here to talk to us about two things. And first, we're going to start off with looking at security, cyber crime, all the things to do with running a small business and how you need to be protecting yourself from those hackers out there. Who knows, the Russians or somebody. Anyway, we are very happy to have you here.
Well, thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Good to have somebody so smart in this area. So take us back to, when did hacking begin and where did it start?
Well, you know, hacking has a long and varied history. So it depends on how you define it as to what you've got. Hacking as a term about computer hacking, which most people are familiar with, started in the 60s out of the computer labs at MIT, Carnegie Mellon, and Berkeley and other leading computing centers.
So wait a minute, they started in the colleges?
Yes, but the term hacking at that time just meant cleverly solving problems.
Okay.
Okay.
But the way we think of hacking nowadays is criminal behavior that disrupts our life and steals our money.
Yeah.
And of course that started when the banks went online in the turn of the millennium.
And so overall, how much does hacking cost the economy?
Well, it's hard to say that because so much of it goes unreported and undetected. As an example, just one of the operations that they're aware of. It was first detected in September of 2015 and is still going on to this day. Hmm. It's netting $3 to $5 million of profit for the criminal organization every day.
A day. That leads me to my first question for you about this criminal behavior, and it has to do with ransomware. And I think that the news about ransomware was really hot a couple years ago, and that's when a friend of mine who runs a small one-person business, he makes fishing poles, and he had his client lists, his billing, his accounting, everything on this computer, and a big message came up and said that he'd been frozen up by ransomware.
Right.
Pay up or you'll never see your computer again in terms of being able to work. He now, after having gone through the whole process, regrets having thrown up his hands in anger, pulled the plug on it, and said, I'm taking this into my computer geeks like you, I am not paying this ransom. After all was said and done, it took him 3 weeks to get his computer back. He never got his family photos back. And he said that if he had to do it again, he would have probably just paid, I think it was $500 ransom,
right,
because it saved him. It would have saved him time and a whole lot of angst over the whole deal. So what do you do about ransomware?
Well, you need to be prepared for ransomware before it hits.
Okay.
The ransomware programs, all when they come in, they encrypt your data. And they encrypt it in a way that's irreversible most times.
Right, that's what happened.
So you don't really, you can't take it to your computer geek and have it decrypted. That would take centuries, and you just don't have the time or the patience for that. You have to have a good, solid, offline backup of the data before the ransomware hits.
So a backup.
So backup,
another
but
computer,
offline.
Another computer in the basement or something? Or?
Ideally, something like Carbonite or Mozy or iDrive. It's a different system that you don't have any control over, but you just put your data there.
And it does it automatically?
Automatically, as soon as you save the file.
Every time you update
Yeah,
the files.
With Carbonite, which is the my favorite one, with Carbonite, as soon as you save a file, it gets marked for upload and it's backed up within seconds. The most important files that you're working with are the ones you started working on yesterday. Right?
That's
the
right.
Old ones you don't care about as much.
Yeah.
So you need instantaneous backup. And you need it to be offline because viruses and worms and these kinds of encrypting programs, they'll go looking for your backup and encrypt that as well.
What?
Yeah.
Wow. So how much is this going to cost?
It's like $60 a year.
A year?
Oh, that's not
well, that's
which
not
is
bad
nothing.
At all.
Yeah, you should
so
do
I guess I want to follow up on this one more time, though. I get the idea that a lot of small business people never get around to setting up the backup because they're just too darn busy and things are going along, and they hardly have time to keep their computer running, let alone deal with, you know, the backup for ransomware.
Right.
Is that right? What's the message there?
Well, you can just buy and place your backup on your server, and you'll be done.
Oh,
yeah, it's,
okay.
It's easy enough to do.
Huh.
And your IT guy, whoever it is, will be able to do that for you. People are waiting, but they shouldn't be.
Okay.
I want to go back to the ransomware where your friend was saying, I wish I had paid.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, if he had paid, don't you think then the hackers are saying, well, this person is ripe for more. You know, I'll pay the ransom, I'll get my computer back, and then, you know, down the road, the same thing happens again. I mean, is that kind of their MOS?
That's the way it works with ransoms in the general world, but this stuff that's happening to people is automated to such an extent that there's no human being sitting there going, you know.
There's no one to even get mad at.
They're not thinking about you as an individual or as a person who they scammed in the past. They got you this time, you paid the ransom, they did or didn't return your data.
That's the other issue.
The most recent ransomware, like the first one, you paid the ransom and you got your data back, mm-hmm. which was brilliant marketing on the part of this organization. But the most recent one was the WannaCry virus.
That's right.
They only collected something like $150,000 in ransoms. Hmm. We know that because we can see the account that the money was all credited to. Now we can't access the account. We don't know who owns that account because it's in Bitcoin. But the transactions are all there for us to look at, and we can see that they made $150,000 by destroying 300,000 computers. Yeah. That's not good odds. But they also, when you paid the ransom, didn't return your data.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
That's awful. Yeah. So. What is this costing businesses, the small businesses especially, because those are the ones that, you know, probably don't think about the backup.
Or they may not have the IT department. Mm-hmm.
That's right. They're doing it themselves because they're mom and pop.
Right.
You know, what can they do that's going to keep them in business, that's going to keep the hackers at bay in some form, or is that really an impossibility today?
No, I think it's possible to stay in business and to make plans and think through what might happen, right? So you want to have a backup system that's instantaneous and local, right? Backing up to a USB hard drive with a product like Acronis or Macrium that can, you know, has an image of your hard drive. So you replace the hard drive or you wipe the hard drive that's been infected and you re-image it from a drive, and that can take, you can be back up in a matter of hours. Then you have an off-site backup like Mozy or iDrive or Carbonite. So that if your place burns down or someone steals your laptop and all
good
of the stuff in your house.
It's not just hackers you really ought to be worrying about.
There's a lot of contingencies, yeah.
Okay, that don't have to do with hacking.
Anything else besides those two things?
Well, an earthquake in Oregon, right?
Oh, there you go, okay.
That's true, anything, you know. I mean, anything to protect the information that you have, whether it does come, you know, from possible hacking or from, you know, Mother Nature.
Right.
You know, okay. You know, as of late, we hear about some very big companies, and the companies that you would not expect to get hacked at all, like Equifax, who has all of our information.
It has everything. It knows everything about me, including my Social Security number.
Exactly.
Right.
I did go and freeze up my four credit
bureaus. Yeah, I saw that there was four. That makes sense.
And I went and did that because I don't plan on borrowing any big money anytime soon, but I guess that would be a hassle.
Okay, but so what can hackers do with the information that they get from Equifax or from Yahoo or from, you know, Target or from
There's nobody left, is there?
Yeah, who hasn't been hacked. I mean, what kind of damage can be done, you know, on the business side but also on the personal side?
Well, there's two main things that they get when they hack into these companies. The first is your password combinations, right? Your email address and the password that's associated with it. And that can be really valuable because many people use the same password or they use a family of passwords for all of their accounts. It's very difficult to memorize a password that's really good. And that means that they can then take that password and use it in other places and test it using automated tools. And the other thing, of course, is getting the raw data with which to create new accounts. So they could open a new credit card in your name and then you're liable for it. They could steal your health insurance and go and get themselves fixed up and give you the bill. Or lately, I guess the latest innovation is they can file a tax return in your name and take your withholdings, and then you're on the hook to reimburse the government for those withholdings.
Now, some of these things are on the personal side that we're going to talk to in our next episode. So getting back to business owners, and I guess I would call small business owners those that have maybe 1 to 150 employees. And I'm not sure who some of your clients are. Do they fit into that category?
My clientele is mostly from the 1 to 20 employees range.
Okay.
And there is a big difference as you get larger. You start to have dedicated IT staffs, and you start to be able to spend the money for more expensive surveillance systems. So I would suppose that if you've got 50 to 150 employees, that you're already paying really good money for really good experts to keep you safe and backed up.
Can you buy insurance as a business against this so that if you do get hacked and your business is down for any length of time?
Or it burns up in a fire.
Right. So can you
buy insurance? Of course you can get insurance for that. But a lot of the times when you lose your computer system, it costs you a lot of time and energy, right?
Like,
so insurance can only help you so much there, right? You're not going to get a policy that's going to say, oh, you were out of business, you were out of contact for a week, and you lost three clients. Like, there's no insurance company that's going to be able to write a policy that reimburses you for lost business because you couldn't respond in a timely fashion while you were recovering from this.
So probably not worth, even worth doing that?
I'm not an insurance guy, so maybe
of course
maybe
the insurance
guy is
going to say,
somebody
of course,
else, but
it's a good deal.
I think that you could get a policy that helped cover some of your losses for sure, but I don't know if I'd advise a small business, a one or two person operation, to buy that kind of coverage.
So the last thing is, I guess, how do you get small business owners motivated to move this to a top priority in terms of their time? In setting up the backup and the offsite backup and doing these basic things that they really should be doing, how do you get them to really think about that?
That's been one of my biggest challenges, frankly.
That's why we're doing this show.
computer people, we pick ourselves based on our technical skills, not our social skills, and people don't really judge us on our social skills that much. So, I count sales as part of that. I think that I'm friendly and affable, and maybe a little more than the stereotype for a computer person, but I have a very difficult time convincing a client to make a given action. I put out the options. I tell them this is the wise course of action, and I might repeat that over and over again. And some people resort to scare stories, But aside from trying to scare someone or trying to just be very friendly and affable and recommending it over and over again, it comes down to the business person and where they're at and what they're ready to think about.
It's kind of a case of, well, it won't happen to us. It just happens to the big guys, like the big department stores and that kind of thing. Maybe
it's that true kind of that mindset. You're not much of a target. I mean, no one's going to pay a lot of money to have a high-skilled hacker crack into your network just to steal some QuickBooks data.
It's just ransomware for $500 that generates the millions out there in space somewhere.
At this point, I wouldn't pay the ransom. It's just too dicey, and it gives money to people that hurt you.
I like that.
Yeah.
So your association, just to give you a little plug, if a business owner was interested in finding out more about this or getting some help with it, he can go to your website, which is?
It's OCCA.org.
Okay. And that is the Oregon Computer Consultants Association. And there's 25 of you?
Yeah, there's 25, and we have various specialties, but we're mostly working with small businesses to keep their computers, safe.
And do they feel safe today? I mean, it seems as though every day there seems to be another story that comes out about, a large corporation that's been hacked, and therefore it trickles down to individuals. So are businesses in general feeling
are
better?
Are we winning?
Well,
we,
good
maybe
question.
Are we
are
winning?
We winning or are
We're
they
clearly
winning?
Losing.
Oh,
yeah.
No!
We're clearly losing, right? The Target breach gave away usernames and passwords. And the biggest thing you can do as an individual or a small business is get better at managing your passwords using password management software.
Huh.
Huh. There's just no excuse for it anymore.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. What kind of, what would be the name of a password management software?
There's a really good one called iPassword. There's one called KeePass. And the one that I use is LastPass. And any one of them encrypts your passwords for you, memorizes it for you as you enter them into websites, and will enter it automatically for you so that you don't have to do any more of this copying, pasting, or typing long passwords.
But you know, I think there's a distrust in general anymore about using computers, whether you're a business or on the personal level, for fear that, you know, somebody's going to get into it. So even if you download other software, you know, can I trust that?
Well, there's a lot of worry about it, but yet I think the use of online shopping is up to, like, I just read that half of our Christmas shopping is going to be done online this year for the very first time. I'm doing my banking on my smartphone. I'm looking at my brokerage account. I'm doing a whole bunch of stuff that is, it's like,
Yeah, should you or should
I think I'll get this password automatic.
All right. Well, this to be continued, because there is a lot more to discuss, even on the personal level, of what we really need to do to protect ourselves. Because, I mean, this, you know, and as you say, we're losing. So
we're clearly losing. Yes. The Equifax breach was huge.
Yeah.
And it was a new order of magnitude in terms of the kinds of data and the abilities that they have with that data.
Yeah, and I think people felt, I think, distrustful of that company for the way they handled it as well.
That was pretty bad, too.
Of waiting. Yeah. And then, you know, you hear about the CEOs of these companies walking away with wonderful golden parachutes.
Sure.
Worth millions of
dollars. There's a lot to be upset about.
There is. And you make the point, though, you know, if you get angry, then you probably will get, you will change
will
do something about it, and you will change your attitude about protecting yourselves.
It's possible, yeah.
Andy, thank you so much.
We really
appreciate this.
Yeah, enjoyed being here.
For more information about today's topic, log on to Julia Anderson's website, 60andsingle.com.